Hi, this is Dr. Deepak Garg from Eye Solutions, and today we have with us Dr. Akshay Nair, who's an oculoplasty specialist, and he's going to be talking to us about mucormycosis. Some of you may have heard him in BBC, Al Jazeera, or the Times Now news channels talking about mucormycosis, and I would like to thank him for being here with us today to explain to our listeners more about the infection. So Akshay, the first question addressed to you is, we know a little bit about mucormycosis. We want to know what it is and why are COVID-19 patients more susceptible to it?
So mucormycosis is a very rare fungal infection. This typically is seen in patients who have a very weak immune system, such as patients who have got diabetes, patients who are on long-term medications that can suppress your immune system, like those who have had an organ transplant, or even patients such as those with HIV/AIDS. It's very unusual to have otherwise healthy patients land up with an infection like mucormycosis, which is why we are now seeing this in patients with COVID-19. We are finding that COVID-19 itself is weakening the local nasal immunity. It is causing diabetes in patients who otherwise don't have diabetes, and in already those who are diabetic, it can really increase the blood sugar to very high levels and therefore make them more susceptible to mucormycosis. Mucormycosis typically starts in the nose and the spaces around the nose called the sinuses, and from there it spreads around the eyes, involves the eyes, the vision, and if not treated at this stage, it can even spread into the brain.
Okay, what is the rate of infection that you have seen in the past few weeks or months, and how is mucor different in COVID patients and non-COVID patients?
That's a great question, Dr. Deepak. We're seeing mucormycosis in very high rates. To give you an idea, in the past couple of years, I may have seen no more than 10 patients of mucormycosis all put together. But in the past 4-5 months alone, we've seen more than 50 patients at a single hospital. So that's almost 5 times as many patients in a very short span of time. Also, the other thing that we are seeing this time is mucormycosis is being far more aggressive. Typically, we won't see as many patients of mucormycosis where the fungal infection has reached the eye or the brain. But this time, after COVID, we are seeing a lot more patients where the eye is involved.
Okay, Akshay, can you tell us, you know, I have actually been asked this question even by some of my friends and patients. Why are we seeing mucor only in India? Or why are we hearing reports of mucor only from India and not from other countries? Does it have to do with us being the diabetic capital of the world?
That's actually part of the answer, but I think there is more to it than just diabetes. Interestingly, the first case in medical literature of mucormycosis after COVID-19 came from the United States. And speaking to some of my colleagues from Iran, they've also had a brief wave of mucormycosis after COVID-19. So it's not an isolated phenomenon in India, but the scale at which we are seeing it is definitely unprecedented. As you said, India is the capital of diabetic capital of the world, which means we have the highest number of patients who are diabetic, highest number of diabetic patients who are undertreated, which means they're not taking as much medicine as they should, and also the highest number of undiagnosed diabetes. So when an infection like COVID comes along, which medically is called as a diabetogenic infection, which can increase the intensity of the diabetes or can cause non-diabetics to become diabetes in a small proportion, something like this can, you know, really change things, because mucormycosis typically is seen in uncontrolled diabetes. Another factor that is adding fuel to the fire here is the use of steroids. Now, steroids are a life-saving group of drugs which have to be used in critical cases of COVID in order to increase the survival. But as a side effect, steroids can raise your blood sugar level. So some amount of indiscriminate use of steroids, some self-medication of steroids, in addition to the diabetes which is not diagnosed and treated in time, all of these put together are the factors that make it just right for an opportunistic infection like mucormycosis to show up.
Excellent. What are the misconceptions that you have come across in the past few weeks? I know I have received calls from patients thinking that they have mucor for the smallest of eye problems, which they wouldn't have really paid attention to before. But now, having heard of so much mucor on the news, so many people think they have mucor.
Right.
What are similar stories that you want to tell our listeners?
I think the most common and the most important thing that people should know is that mucormycosis is not a contagious disease. This does not spread from a person who already has the infection to someone who doesn't. The fungus, mucor, itself is present all around us. It's present in the air, in the dust, in the soil, even on food that we may eat. But a healthy person like you or me would automatically be able to fight this infection off. It's only when the local immunity in the nose and the general immunity of the body is reduced by, say, diabetes that is not controlled, that it makes someone very, very vulnerable. The other thing that I've heard is, I get redness in my eyes. Do I have black fungus?
Yeah.
Something as simple as redness or watering of your eye is unlikely to be the first presenting sign of mucormycosis.
Speaking of diabetes, have you seen mucormycosis patients in individuals who don't have diabetes?
Deepak, that's a great question, because we're now analyzing the data that we've seen from so many patients over the past few months, and we've just about begun putting the pieces together. There is a very small subset of patients who were known to be non-diabetic before they got COVID-19. And after contracting and recovering from COVID-19, they're now found to be diabetic. And it was unfortunate that by the time they realized that they were now diabetic, mucormycosis had already infected, and it was mucormycosis that brought them to the hospital, at which time diabetes was diagnosed. But I must stress that there is no need to panic, because this really is a very, very small subset of patients in whom we are seeing.
Thanks. We already know that it's a deadly infection. We know that the survival rate is around 50% or 60% for this type of an infection. And obviously that causes worry. Can you tell our listeners what should they be aware of, or what are the symptoms that they should then seek an opinion from an ophthalmologist or from an oculoplasty specialist like yourself to rule out whether they have mucor or not?
So typically mucormycosis, like I mentioned, is something that starts in the nose. It begins in the nose and then goes into the sinuses. Sinuses are the spaces around the nose, and from there it enters the eye or the orbit. The orbit is the space around the eye, and then it spreads into the brain. So typically, if you've got symptoms related to nasal stuffiness, nasal blockage, a foul smelling discharge from the nose, crusting that you can see at the nostrils, pain around the cheeks, which is basically pain in the sinuses, pain in between the eyes or the forehead, facial swelling. This facial swelling is typically on one side of the face, or any numbness on one side of the face. All of these are the early signs of mucormycosis, which can be treated with an ENT surgeon. An ENT surgeon can do a surgery known as a sinus debridement, and with the right amount of drugs, this can be treated. But by the time it has reached the eye, at which time you will present with symptoms of blurred vision, double vision, or even loss of vision, it's probably the stage where you would probably have to undergo a surgery in the eye as well. So this can be detected and diagnosed early, and definitely be treated if diagnosed in time.
Now, in terms of prevention, is there anything that somebody can do to prevent getting infected with the mucormycosis?
Right. So like I said, the whole point is not to panic about something like mucormycosis. We need to be calm and understand that only a small group of people are susceptible or vulnerable to this disease. This includes those who have recovered from COVID-19, those who are already diabetic patients, and those who have received any dose of steroids during the course of their COVID-19 infection. This group needs to be very alert of any of the symptoms that we discussed earlier. And for those who've already recovered from COVID, a good starting point would be to get a blood sugar test done. This can be done at home or at your nearest blood pathology laboratory, and just to get an idea if your blood sugar is under control. Because at the end of the day, one thing that is common amongst all the mucormycosis patients we've treated is that they have a high blood sugar level.
So I think in summary, what you're saying is your diabetes has to be under control and you have to be aware of the early symptoms. And a combination of these two factors can help in detecting early mucor patients.
Absolutely. The best form of treatment for mucormycosis is preventing it.
Yes.
Because once you have it, it's a long course of treatment. It can be treated. We have to be aggressive and operate them. But keeping safe and diagnosing early is the best thing that you can do. And I'd also like to take this opportunity to tell all our viewers and patients that it is only in the faith in the science of vaccines that gives doctors like Dr. Deepak and me the strength to work in these times. So stay safe and make sure you get vaccinated when you get the chance.
What are the treatment options for this infection? I also have read, and we all have, that there's a shortage of the drugs that are being used to treat mucor. Have you experienced this shortage in the treatment, and what is the solution around this for patients?
Right. So, like we discussed, when this infection is limited to the nose and the sinuses, an ENT specialist or a ear, nose, throat doctor is the right person to treat it at that stage, where they go into the sinuses and can do a clearance surgery called sinus debridement. Along with this, controlling your diabetes and receiving the right amount of antifungal medicine, which is called amphotericin B, is extremely important. You're right in saying that we are facing shortages of this drug. There have been some cases where even our patients have had to look high and low in order to get this medication. There are a couple of other drug alternatives like isavuconazole and posaconazole that we've resorted to tide over the temporary crisis. But thankfully, the supplies have started coming back, and now our patients with mucormycosis are receiving the drug.
Perfect. Now, two more questions now. I have a question as to what if a doctor is not 100% sure whether the patient has mucor, all right? Does he start treatment or does he closely observe the patient?
So if there are any signs and symptoms that you suspect it could be mucormycosis, your referring doctor should be an ENT doctor. You have to refer it to an ENT specialist. The way to diagnose mucormycosis is a nasal swab, much like how it is done for a COVID test. Yeah, so your doctor will put in a swab, probably he'll put an endoscope in the nose, and a quick swab is taken, which is then checked under the microscope to confirm the diagnosis of mucormycosis. Later on, scans can be done, like an MRI scan of the brain, the eyes, and the sinuses to confirm this disease and see how much it is spread.
Perfect. Okay, finally, we are now hearing about a white fungus, a yellow fungus, and what are these? Is it the same thing? Is it something different? And is it as deadly as mucor?
Right. Unfortunately, in this state of panic, we are seeing a lot of reports about yellow fungus and white fungus, like you said. These are names that are common names given by the media, by press, and used, which could possibly confuse the layman. Yellow fungus is usually referring to a disease called aspergillosis, and white fungus is usually referring to candidiasis. Now, both these fungal infections have been around since way before COVID-19, and they are likely to hang around till even after the current pandemic eases off. It's just that at this heightened state of awareness, even if there are a few reports of these fungal infections, they tend to make the headlines. Right now, the news isn't as worrying, the numbers aren't as high, so I would request everybody not to panic about these different colors and funguses. For the medical practitioners and doctors, our main aim at this point in time remains mucormycosis, or what is called the black fungus. So we'll stick to that and focus on that. Nothing else at this stage should worry people. They really shouldn't be losing their sleep over yellow and white fungus.
Perfect. Thank you so much. In summary, mucormycosis is an infection that we don't want to get. It's happening in patients who have had COVID, who are diabetic and who have received steroids. You know the early symptoms. You know how important blood sugar control has become or has come to limelight because of this infection. We also know how it is treated. It's a treatment which is done by two specialties, an ENT or a ear, nose, throat specialist and an ophthalmologist. We hope you find this video useful. Akshay, thank you so much for joining us today.